are true to our creed, when a little girl born into the bleakest poverty knows that she has the same chance to succeed as anybody else. Because she's an American, she's free, and she's equal. Not just in the eyes of God, but in the eyes of our own, as said by our own President Barack Obama. As affirmative, we believe that college tuition should be a guaranteed right for all citizens. Currently, college students are going into severe debt while trying to pursue a degree. Student loan debt has surpassed credit card debt as one of the lead forms of debt in America. Also, with an upwards of $1 trillion of debt, it has become one-sixth of our deficit. The institutions in place to help, such as government grants and scholarships, are not rising to compensate for this rise in tuition. And broke college students and their parents are having to rely on risky loans. In order to change this problem, we must make college tuition a guaranteed right for all the following advantages. First, individuals would have an equal opportunity. Second, there will be a stronger workforce. First, individuals will have equal opportunity. Subpoint A, social strata. Defined as hierarchy or vertical division of society according to rank, caste, or class, we suffer from a college attainment gap. As high school student graduates from the wealthiest families in our nation are almost certain to continue on higher education, while just over half of high school graduates in the poorest families are having to go on to college. By guaranteeing tuition to all citizens, we are opening the door to equality of education. This allows for the experience of college to be attainable to every person with the desire to expand their knowledge. If a student does not feel they have the sufficient amount of financial support to pursue a degree, this may discourage them from continuing on. Ultimately, they may find themselves dropping out, and while more than half of college students graduate within 6 years, the completion rate for low-income students is around 25%. This is unfair because those at the lower end of the social strata are feeling like they are being left out. Second advantage is more skilled workers, better service, and better quality of life. Today's job market calls for the best of the best. In order to prove worth and intellectual ability, one must have some form of post-secondary education. A college degree provides intellectual variance, skill, and ability. Only through this level of education can one receive the skills required to succeed in the workforce. Education is the key to success. Citizens having tuition as a guaranteed right allows for more students to go to college and actually graduate, which will provide for a stronger workforce. Take, for instance, those foreign countries who have already adopted the free tuition policy. Take, for instance, Ireland, who says that free university education allows all of their individuals to attend university, guaranteeing that the leaders of tomorrow have the chance to show their worth. Subpoint B, more college graduates. By instituting a free higher level education, you are undoubtedly going to increase the number of graduates. This is because the number one reason students drop out of college is because of money. According to Washington Post, Public Agenda, a nonpartisan public policy research firm conducted that 600 people between the ages of 22 and 30 found that the number one reason why they had to drop out was trying to struggle, going to work, and going to school. So finally, to conclude, our president was right when he said education is not a luxury but a necessity. Those pursuing a higher education should not have to go bankrupt in the process. As a nation, we have a duty to defend education as a guaranteed right. By allowing this, we are going to have the advantage of equal opportunity within the social strata and a stronger workforce within our economy, and ultimately a better quality of life.
Oh, isn't it? Yeah, questions. Yeah.
But wouldn't allowing more people in college make it, there would be more of
evaluating how we are spending our money and where we're spending it at.
Do you think middle school and high school compared to college?
I don't, well, for me personally, I don't know if that's a personal, it's kind of subjective, objective. I think it depends on where you're from and where you grew up and what school you go to, and that's why it affects the social strata. Basically, you know, if you're growing up in a poor society, you're not going to get as great of an education. So that's the unfair ability in a higher education system.
Do you think studying to pass a standardized test is necessary for college? Do you think SATs are really good for going to college?
Good for going to college? I'm not really sure about that.
Whenever y'all ready.
Of course, free college does sound appealing, but college should not be. Should be free. The economist Matt Brennan makes an excellent note of this in the detail notes. He understands that the relation between rich kids in college and poor kids in college. That rich kids in the upper half in general dramatically represent the nation's four-year universities. My point of the post is that if four-year universities were free, poor kids would be better represented. This is false. Both today and back in the day, the overwhelming barrier that kids with poor families face in attending college is not the cost of tuition, but low admission test scores. It's known that if kids are from a poor place, they can achieve high test scores and still receive financial assistance. Economics Matthew Gibbs states, we can debate the origins of the test score gap, but it is what it is. Increasing the level of subsidy available to a four-year institution would be a major progressive step in the education system and could lead to a high school fire too. Another major problem among granting free tuition is if subsidies were increased enough to get rid of tuition could cause a dramatic change. Think of the faculty and administrators that receive their money from tuition paid from students. These people would thirst for more money would lead them to look into private universities to supply their fine stuff, possibly making public universities' degrees far less superior to privates because of lack of experienced staff. The affirmative wants to eliminate the cost of tuition, but logically you should raise the price of tuition since how highly valued a college degree is in today's market. Eliminating tuition with staff growth such as better facilities and perks for universities. Universities like UNT that have specialized schools with jazz and debate would be obsolete. The schools would soon be non-existent because the government money would be involved and they would regulate the caps where the money would be spent. The competitiveness of schools would be at an all-time high. Schools such as UT that once had a top 10% acceptance rates moved to top 8% in 5 years because of the amount of students that were applying. This could decrease dramatically to even 0.1%. That being said, if the staff even stays, it doesn't shift to a private university. If there is no consumer demand, then the price will naturally go down. What my opponent has to understand is the education system is a business. And if it became government regulated, it would be more detrimental than beneficial. Caps would be placed on universities and amenities would decrease. The biggest problem I see with making tuition free is where the education institutions should spend their money. The government will focus on getting students ready for college rather than college itself. If the government spent money on high-poverty high schools, elementaries, and middle schools, they could decrease the test score gap by directly funding underserved institutions. We can all agree that the best-known institutions are private, yet they are not free. National parks are public institutions, but they aren't free. You just can't give everyone the same thing and not expect to get mediocre results. As the old saying goes, you get what you pay for. Today, young people are already having the entitled mentality, which is that everything should be given to. If you want to exceed in certain things, you have to make certain sacrifices to obtain them. Paying for college is a sacrifice that has to be made in order to obtain the reward. Better jobs, certain lifestyles, and different standards of living. If everything's the same, the economic scale would be limited and reduce competitiveness. Today in America, we have some of the best best doctors, some of the best lawyers, and some of the best teachers. This is because of paying for interest.
Cross-ex? It's the Negatech now.
Yeah. Oh, the Negatech?
Yeah. Yeah, so y'all should be going.
Yeah.
Oh, the full chart is affirmative defense.
I think
it's Negatech right now.
Yeah.
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 It's F neg neg F.
You're answering the affirmative advantages. Yeah, they're answering the advantages from the first speech from y'all.
It's flawless. What was his speech?
His speech was separate disadvantages to like the affirmative.
It's how the debate is formatted, basically.
Yeah. Yeah, then it'll be the AF attack.
Yeah.
The philosophy of college education being a right is not proven by the affirmative, because they have not directly stated how we could implement and guarantee a right to education. Simply put, we don't have the money, resources, or people to guarantee that everyone has the right to college. The judge should vote negative due to the fact that the affirmative have not given a proper resolution stated by the problem stated at hand. In the world of free subsidized education, college still has the ability to turn down students, and that's what they would do if it was free. The system is different than what the affirmative has stated. Solution because of the affirmative is stating that the college education should be a natural right guaranteed to everyone. So in the world of the affirmatives resolution, no one could be turned down from college because it is a right. To declare college education a natural right is silly because if college was free, we couldn't even finance it, thus causing the natural right to be violated by the government. In short, their argument is false. If this resolution were to ever be implemented, the quality of college education would dramatically go down. Their argument is stout in deontology. More clearly, the means do not justify the ends. Thus, we should take a more deontologist approach. If I win this argument, I have minimized their position and fundamentally turned the tables. With regards to individuals should have an equal opportunity, the government does not have enough funds to cover this expansive overall of higher education. The government has a national debt of $17 trillion. That's from the U.S. debtclock.org. Government is already too powerful and too large. Federal government control over the higher education system would only cause more problems by out-of-touch Washington bureaucrats. A September 23rd Gallup poll showed that 6 in 10 Americans believe that the federal government has too much power. With regards to social strata, this argument is flawed because having free subsidized college education will cause universities to be more selective in their decisions to allow students in because the government will see them as investments. As with regards to education as being a necessity, all of the social strata and education as necessity arguments are problematized by poor elementary teaching. With regards to more skill, better service, the amount of rejection will go up so they can simply have enough money to pay for the student education. With regards to more college graduates, obviously there will be more selective and exclusive colleges, training the best students because they're selective by nature. And an open-door policy fundamentally dissolves this argument. And I'm done. 1 minute.
Well, it's cross-sex and then attack.
Sure?
Yeah. Okay. So he goes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So, yeah, F cross-sex.
So you believe that we should improve the K through 12 system? You believe in improving the K through 12 education?
In order to make college education better.
So, give me a reason why improving K through 12 education has any relevance to the question at hand, which is paying for college tuition.
By improving K through 12 education, it would better prepare students for college education, thus making college education better.
But the question is college tuition, not whether students are prepared for college education. It's about paying for that education. So, basically, K through 12 has no relevance in paying for college tuition, if I'm hearing you correctly?
Yes, then you would be correct.
Okay. So, you also believe that improving K through 12 education is going to help give more scholarships to students in the long run? Is that correct?
No, I never said that.
No, you never said that. Okay.
Whenever you're ready.
So the opposing to the negative side says that making college tuition free would not benefit, and they were saying that it would pretty much damage taxes, but the average cost of taxes in Texas is around $2,000, while the average cost of college tuition is around $20,000. So if I can have any hands, we'd rather pay $2,000 than $20,000. Exactly. And according to them, they were saying that we don't have any money to fund, but we have enough money to go to war. We have enough money to pay celebrities and do all this extra stuff, so why don't we have enough money to fund the next Steve Jobs, the next president? And according to public universities should be free, they're saying if this country can build the world's largest military fight open ended wars in multiple theaters across the globe, it can find a way for paying for public education. And I do agree. And also, he was talking about debts that the United States does have. Well, as students, we do have debts called loans. And according to Forbes, in 2011, the average student loan debt was nearly $30,000, while the government average Pell Grant, which is funded by the government, was nearly stayed below $5,000, and that has been since 1977. So since 1977 to 2011, it has been under $5,000, while student loans have grown over $30,000. Also, college can, quote unquote, be free because they have plenty of options for college students to do. You can either join the military, that's free, keep a grade point average, and give your time back to the military. According to Hopkins, 12 tuition-free colleges, there are numerous colleges that have prospective students who must audition, so this can lower the competition because, as y'all were saying, K through 12 argument, which is a red herring fallacy and has nothing to do with college education. But to go against that, to lower down the competition, you would have to audition for certain prestige schools. And also, at Kentucky's Berry College offers a similar deal where you can work up to 10 hours on campus, so you're pretty much working on campus to pay your tuition. So at that time, it's free, and there's no taxes involved, because while you're in college, you're working on campus to work towards your tuition. Also, they were stating that that poor kids equal bad grades, or is it by the individual? Everyone comes to college as an individual, and if they're saying that the government regulation will be changed, that's insignificant because you can go to college and get on a scholarship, but what happens when your scholarship runs out? You have no money and you lost your education. There's plenty of students that have gone to college and need to get into grad school but don't have money to pay it because of their poverty situation. So I would say that having the state grant free college education to all citizens that they will have the opportunity to do it as well, because the rich kids, they can be rich all day, but be very ignorant. There are some poor kids out here that have the drive, the education, the determination to become the best doctors in the world. So saying that poor kids need to be better with middle school is really insignificant.
Yeah, for cross-ex. Yes.
Okay, so you said that the federal government has enough money to fund the report. Specifically, you said the most recent one, right?
Yes, and all of us have been having to
do that. Right. So that comes out of the defense budget. But what evidence shows that the federal government has the means to provide open door access to higher education?
When they can give out scholarships, they give grants, and numerous scholarships, there's a lot of universities.
Is there.
time. Sorry. You're good. So now it's the
aft defense.
Yeah, aft defense. The aft defense.
Charging more and more every year, and Americans can't keep up with these rising rates. Student loans are causing major debt, and young Americans are having to put off buying houses, buying cars, starting families, etc. We can see this as tuition fees are up 439% since 1982, while income is only up 147%. So as a result, student borrowing has doubled since 1998. And that shows that our opponent believes that we should possibly raise the cost of tuition. But really, the income is not there to raise tuition. That would simply bury Americans and young Americans and even offset them further from starting families and living the rest of their life. College being free would allow more money to be pumped into the system. If you look at it, students would not have to spend money on school. Rather, they would get through school, get a good job, and allow them to spend their income that they are making more freely instead of trying to pay off debt. If this country can build the world's largest military and fight open-ended wars in multiple theaters across the globe, they can find a way to pay for public education, as stated by Beatty in 2013. We've also seen evidence of California schools openly admitting that they accept more out-of-state students and rejecting students from California in order to make more money. So the schools are also against the students in that regard, in which they're just trying to make the most more money. They don't value necessarily who is getting the education, whereas if education was free, we would not run into that problem. Repayment of loans can take decades, leaving students underneath the thumb of creditors for much of their working lives. Also, improved workers and quality of life is another major issue that would be helped by making tuition free. With more people having college degrees, Americans will be more educated, and more educated Americans results to more efficient employees. In an article by Jacobs in 2012, he stated, compared to 10 years ago, more jobs today require technical skills and a higher education level. By contrast, there are fewer entry-level jobs, meaning more people need to go to school in order to go and get a job. Those that aren't going to college don't have those jobs as freely. It's more difficult to get a job. The Huffington Post also released an article that read, if all 18 and 20-year-olds were in college, we would reduce unemployment rate by 2 million people, removing the need for students to go into debt, and the government would allow graduates to be more productive. They would have more money to spend, which in turn boosts and stimulates the economy.
And now the neg defense.
through 12 preparedness for college and how that will affect costs of school. Well, I don't know about you guys, but I got my admissions letter before I wrote a check to UT. If college cost isn't so much the importance of why a lot of students from lower-income families and lower-income communities can afford to go to college, it's so much that they're not even prepared. According to the FTM Daily, 3/4 of college freshmen are unprepared for college. That's across the board. That's not even just from lower-income families. The Huffington Post states that 43% of test takers in 2013 met SAT's definition of being prepared for college. That's not even half of students that took the SAT. And everyone takes the SAT, not just people from lower-income communities. In response to this, the College Board President David Coleman says, "While some might see stagnant scores as no news, we at College Board see this as a call for action. Schools need to dramatically increase the number of students in K-12 who prepare for college and careers." So what's a free education if you can't even get into college? Free education would mean more people obviously have the opportunity to get into college. That doesn't mean that everyone's going to get admitted. If the government starts to federally fund universities, that's going to mean budget cuts, and everyone knows. My opponents state that states already fund a lot of universities, and we're fortunate enough in Texas that Texas does fund a lot of universities, but not in every state. At Washington State University, when their state pulled out a lot of funding from their schools, they had to cut over 1,080 courses. 517 jobs were eliminated, and 3 academic areas were completely eliminated. And this is all due to a tiny portion of money being pulled out of their schools. Everyone knows that when the federal government's putting their money into anything, they want to micromanage it. That means a lot of things are going to be cut. Now, a lot of students aren't prepared for college in the first place. Courses like remedial classes, they cost us now $5.6 billion. And $3.6 billion of those dollars are directly from taxpayers. So taxpayers already take on majority of college costs. All our opponents want to do is shift those costs from students over to taxpayers more so. 2.2 million college freshmen are still learning high school material. So if they already knew those materials before they enter college, we wouldn't waste money like we are now learning things we should have been prepared for ahead of time. Bob Schaefer, the public educator director of the National Center for Fair and Open Testing, when asked about proponents like No Child Left Behind and the Race to the Top programs, he says, "The data shows a total failure in according to their own measures. Doubling down on unsuccessful policies with more K-12 testing as a common core example is an exercise in futility, not meaningful in school improvement." So government loves to do more standardized testing, so there could be more standardized testing in college. And if that's the case, our quality of education will go down. Right now, our schools like UNT can afford to, you know, offer us nice amenities, nice unions to make our school more appealing so students want to come here over other schools. Well, if they have to go to the government, do you think that Washington's going to care about us needing a new union? No, they won't. So, in response to my opponents, I don't believe that paying for tuition is going to give everyone a fair chance. The basis of the American dream in our country now is that you work hard and you get what you put into it. Not that something to just be handed to them.
Now the AF summary. Whenever you start speaking, that's when
on the affirmative side, we have many valid points on why college education should be free. The negative side has many points as to why it should not be free. However, our sources and research are more thoroughly investigated geared toward the argument at hand. My opponents here, young man to my right, said that we should be looked at as that we should not be looked at as investment by college. However, we attack the fact that we are investments to our future. We are investments to our America and our productivity that we'll be putting out in the future. They say we wanted to portray the fact that the mindset of a U.S. student should not be whether or not we can attend college, but for how long and where. And the, to analyze that, there's a larger magnitude of impact that can develop from the competition-based education. Students will be forced to apply their knowledge in the most effectively possible way to achieve. We would like to, again, summarize the fact that competition is what makes productivity in America. Competition and getting into college should be an arguable debate. Also, we wanted to point out that the opposing side stated that college is never truly free and that our tuition should increase. Like we pointed out, using our 2014 Peter G. Pearson survey, that college right now is at an average of $20,000, when taxes are an average of $2,000. The cost of college tuition compared to the cost of taxes is unparalleled and shows that even with the tax increase, the cost of taxes is easier to obtain. Cost and benefit is clearly in our favor here. Government taxes have seen increasing numbers while college tuition continues to climb in cost. The outcome is more favorable to pay taxes and student loans later on in the future. Like my fellow teammate Cliff pointed out, that there will be impacts later on in life that we do not want to face. I'd also like to point out that the opposing group wants to state that instead of allowing students to attend college for free of charge, that we should be using our resources in grades K-12. My team would like to point out that we do not feel that we need to debate that topic because, again, it is a red herring fallacy. That is in no way relevant to our debate. It's just a distraction from the issue at hand. We all agree that, yes, our education system should be improved K-12, but unfortunately, that is not what we're talking about today. This point is in no way relevant, and we provide no evidence of any statement. Our points were more thorough and relevant to the debate and no way distraction from the topic given. All of our points had to conclude with why college should be free and how it could increase developativity and quality in our education for the future of America.
And then now, y'all want to go ahead and do the other app summary? Yeah. They're just going to do a speech back-to-back since they have an extra person.
Finally, to have free tuition will drive the economy forward and create a path of success. according to the National University of Singapore. By giving individuals equal opportunity to have higher education, the timeline impacts faster by creating a strong economic and better workforce for America. Therefore, tuition should be free.
Last but not least, the next summary.
Everyone has a right to a college education. We firmly believe that this is guaranteed to all citizens, but just because it's a right doesn't mean everyone should get it. Everyone has a right to a driver's license, but that doesn't mean everyone should be granted the right to drive. Should college education be more acceptable? Sure. Should it be more regulated? Yes, it should. But free education is not the answer. As students, we get out what we put in. We go to a university that offers services for any need we could possibly think of. We have a wonderful campus that is steadily growing more and more than it has ever before. We have a beautiful football stadium, and we'll soon have a baseball stadium to go along with it. We even have a new union on the way. None of these amenities that are part of UNT's name today would be possible with government-funded education. Higher cuts are already weakening the college system as is. As my colleagues pointed out, at Washington State University, over 1,000 courses were removed, 16 degrees were phased out, and over 500 jobs were eliminated. This also froze enrollment for resident undergraduates, reduced hundreds of hours for student counseling services, and eliminated 12 degree programs. This is proof that free higher education does not mean more college graduates. If anything, it's less graduates because the competition will be higher, the budget will be smaller, and colleges will no longer accept more students as an incentive for tuition. A plan for free college tuition has been discussed before by the government. In 2005, the Secretary of Education, Margaret Spellings, created a national strategy for higher education in which she tried to impose outcome measurements required on colleges through the regulation of accreditors. And these accreditors are the organizations that give us our federal aid. And this plan will basically allow these accreditors to give a standardized test for colleges for incoming and outgoing students. We don't need to be adding more standardized tests, and we don't need to be taking out of our defense budget. I personally like waking up every morning and not having to fear for my life, so let's just keep the defense budget as it is. What we need to be focusing on is how to improve the systems that are already in place. In a study done by the FTM Daily, over 80% of students said high school was too easy, but then 5 out of 10 college freshmen couldn't find New York or Ohio on a map. 4 out of 5 students currently pursuing a math or science degree feel that their K-12 education didn't prepare them for college. An argument made by the affirmative was that the free education will relieve social strata. Well, according to a science college readiness benchmark, only 6% of African Americans and 15% of Latinos were considered prepared for college. Free education is not going to help these students get into college because they don't have the resources they need to get in from the beginning. Why are we worrying about college tuition when the free tuition that we already have, K-12, isn't working as it is? Saying that free tuition will equalize the social strata is invalid because these students are not going to get in anyway, regardless of whether it's free or not. Do I want to pay for college tuition? No, I don't. I don't want to pay for my apartment rent. I don't want to pay for my groceries. I don't want to pay for my gas, for my car. But these are all necessities for survival and success. We get out of it what we put in, both strenuously and financially. In the words of Benjamin Franklin, an investment in knowledge pays the best interest. Thank you.
3:32. Cool, let's give them a round of applause. Yeah, they all kind of showed up. Yeah, I kind of do what I usually do, general comments. Okay. Have an idea. No problem, they're great range. It's all good.
Have a good time.
Thank you. Hey, Hope, how are you? Thank you.
Great starting.
Gotta go.
Okay.
In the content tab, I guess we talked about it.
Yeah. Yeah. Timekeeper this debate? Okay, so.
Yeah, Kushal ran into your lip.
Yeah, and here's a copy if you want. And it's kind of, it's numbered 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's kind of weird the way it goes, but basically every speech is 4 minutes.
What are we doing?
You can go watch other debates.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for joining us.
No problem.
Even though we were all confused.
Oh, it's all good. Just sometimes it's good to get the first experience.
Thank
I thought y'all
you.
Did
yes,
a great
I might
job.
Do this again.
Thanks.
Do you know when we who?
Oh, y'all are like very concerned with who won.
Yeah.
Everybody won because you got the experience of debate and the gift of friendship.
But if we had
I mean, y'all all. Okay. I think you're all winners.
You can say this, but wink if it was us, and then 2 weeks
like
if it was
you.
Leave
now.
You alone. It wasn't us. What the hell?
Do we not really find out a winner in the very end?
Thank you.
No, you don't. Isn't it great that you just got to participate and how exciting it was?
I gotta watch another one. So is there gonna be another one in here? Another?
Yes, there is.
Yeah, for my class.
Yes. I was about to pass those out.
I'll help you. We need to get started.
Oh, I didn't see
John Walker. So is it actually a winner or a loser?
Thank you.
and a what?
I'm going to go walk
in. So without further ado, we'll get the second debate started.
And if you could just let me know, like, if they don't go the full time, it's where, okay. However long it's been.
Healthcare reform has been a recurring topic of discussion since what seems like the beginning of time. However, since President Obama enacted the Affordable Health Care Act, many Americans have benefited from the ability to now enroll in Medicaid without being overcharged, their insurance being taken away, nor denied for having a pre-existing condition. Though this act allows young adults to remain on their parents' insurance plan until the age of 26, which may be advantageous for some, it still may not help students whose parents are unemployed, nor for those who simply cannot afford coverage. This is why we believe health care should be included in college students' tuition. One huge advantage of tuition covering health care would be that all students cannot be denied any of the health care plans that the university will offer them. Now before, students moving far from home may not have access to providers for their health plans, forcing them to pay a higher deductible and coinsurance. The possible absence of in-network coverage can create extra expenses for students, causing difficult choices if something comes up. Now, if premium college...
She's giving you time signals, you're good.
The premium cost of the college health plans were grouped with other higher education expenses, such as tuition, room and board. It is highly probable that your student loans and or scholarships will be able to assist with that. This can be especially useful, not just for undergraduates, but for graduate students who are often not eligible to receive benefits through their parents, and international students who must, under federal regulation, have coverage as well. Another important advantage is that since an Affordable Health Care Act has been upheld, college students are not only covered, but according to the federal guidance on the government website, Medicaid.gov, they now have multiple paths to getting good insurance now that they didn't have before, and among those paths is the expanded Medicaid eligibility. Now, in the past, Medicaid coverage was limited to narrow populations, including only children, pregnant women, and disabled. But under the health care law, some states are expanding that same eligibility to cover low-income adults. Marm Rosen, co-founder of Health Advocate, Inc., which one of its main objectives is to help people navigate the health benefits, stated, end quote, "It is not impossible that a majority of students currently enrolled will be able to qualify for Medicaid alone, in addition to other plans already available to them because of the Affordable Health Care Act." Now, the Affordable Health Care Act requires that these plans include prescription coverage, offer preventative care, and bump maximum annual benefits to up at least $100,000, among other requirements. According to a 2011 report by the University Risk Management and Insurance Association, some experts show that increasing coverage limits and adding new requirements will drive up premium plans for student plans, but can see they will remain less expensive than individual plans. More importantly, one avenue schools may take to offset premiums is to mandate coverage for all students. This report also suggests doing so would include the premium in the overall cost of attendance, allowing students to receive financial aid funds to cover the premium. Now, when we argue the inclusion of healthcare into college students will benefit all students, we mean just that. Whether students beginning their undergrad, struggling to stay in school, pursuing their master's and beyond, or even traveling from across the world, this healthcare act can only smooth out the transition that every student experiences when pursuing a higher education. And what better way to relieve the stress of knowing that if an emergency occurs, they will get the immediate help they need, along with the capability to afford it.
Cross-ex? Oh, it's like question time, so... Or not. It's cross-ex. The negative will ask F questions.
Skyrocket in tuition rates, and you said that you
Any of you can answer. Go for it.
Any of us? Okay. Well, I mean, it's better to owe loans, I guess, than to owe, like, hospital bills for, like, you mentioned that grad students would also need that the benefit from having tuition included in healthcare. 22% of grad students are over the age of 40. What about those kinds of students who are spouses who are attaching on current jobs who are students in grad school and are already covered under? Should they be responsible for a tuition?
Well, usually graduate students, their beginning salary and any job would not be, it'd probably be low and probably wouldn't be able to afford it. Like she mentioned, that if it was included in their tuition and the loans would cover it also, it'd be easier to pay back the loans that you had taken out as opposed to the loans that are already in place because you're a graduate student, all on top of extra hospital bills.
So it should also, that 22% of students, and also the students who are in graduate school with GI Bill.
Cool, so the neg constructive?
With each passing year in the United States, more college students are spiraling in crippling debt. The United States government is responsible for attempting to enact an even more expensive regulation on a demographic that will be hurt the most and benefit the least from it. This expensive and unnecessary regulation is the Affordable Health Care Act being paid for by college students' tuition. College students are the healthiest, yet the poorest among us in this nation. Yet the United States government believes students should be forced to incur even more college debt while already being in an increasingly bloated tuition system. If enforced, having mandatory health insurance through higher tuition is completely unnecessary for the vast majority of college students. In fact, in 2010, studies have stated that 80% of college students already have health insurance through their parents. These students have better coverage, and they personally do not pay a dime to be part of their family's plan. Only 7% of the student body even bother buying insurance through their universities, and these current plans are perfect for them. Recent studies have shown that current university plans are incredibly inexpensive, only costing students around $50 a semester. These plans cover their basic health care needs for the majority of college students. There is no reason to bring the Affordable Health Care Act into universities when these institutions have been getting along perfectly fine without it, and students have been little to no demand for change. Even if a law passed making universities include health care and tuition, it will fail. Ultimately, the majority of students will be subsidizing the few sickly students. We won't have anyone paying for the small minority. This means the deductibles of those who do sign up will be so expensive that no one will be able to afford it anyways. The whole point of the Affordable Health Care Law is to make health care affordable, but with only sick people using up resources, the cost will skyrocket. Another issue will cause cost to go up is that with the Affordable Health Care Act in universities comes higher regulation for what must be included in health plans. Universities can no longer offer cheap basic plans that fit the needs of those students that will use it the most. Instead, it will cover many unnecessary things that will cause the cost to go up. In 2013, Applebee stated that the cost will skyrocket from $100 a year to $1,900 a year. Not only will prices skyrocket due to the lack of people signing up, but someone needs to pay for the facilities. The UNC Health and Wellness Center states that they already see about 22,000 students a semester. With more traffic, the Health and Wellness Center will need larger staff and a bigger building to facilitate their plan. Now, we don't want you to think that we're anti-Affordable Health Care Act. It's a great policy for everyone who needs it, including college students. It's right there online for anyone to check out. I personally looked myself online. It only took a few minutes. I paid a plan outside of my university for about $80 a month, and I paid a deductible. That's $1,000 less than what studies have projected. With universities being involved, it basically causes students to pay the university as a middleman to do all the things that the student can do incredibly easily. Healthcare being included in student tuition seems like a noble idea
Essex? Nag attack speech? So the AF attack speech, or sorry, just kidding, cross-examination. Come on, we're on a schedule, we gotta go.
graduate students are actually sent to grad school? Exactly, you mentioned about them being married, but previously they had their married, said mostly married, or most likely to be married.
That what that mean? That a person over the age of 40 is already has a job and they're moving to grad school because they already have their bachelor's and they're pursuing higher education for a certain career purpose by their employer.
So the assumption that they would also be there over the age of 40.
Well, that's, they are over the age of 40.
Right. Most
it's, yeah, assumption that they're married.
You also mentioned that most undergrads do get basic health care. Do you think that'd be enough in case of an somebody got diagnosed with cancer or just wanted to go and see for preventive services and like that? Like what is basic? What is the basic? Do you think that'd be enough? So we should just forget about the other minority student just because
yeah, but it's like at the beginning
the majority may be healthy enough to be able to
and like each speaker is supposed to have like one advantage, two advantages, two disadvantages, and like so basically one side doesn't answer the other one until the middle of the debate.
You can get it from outside influence, so there should be no need for us to have to pay all this extra money for that.
That's time.
Yeah.
Cool. So the AFATAC speech?
Website who's already started like putting the healthcare thing in motion, the cost of tuition really hasn't gone up at all.
process? Now the after-defense speech.
Postponing future pay, future income, or that we could be getting right now,
for a better future income. We could be at work right now, but we're here. We're at school, so that we can, in 10 years, make $50,000 rather than $20,000. So because of that, we don't work as much. We don't have the kind of money that we would have if we weren't going to school 20, 30, 40 hours, 12-hour days. Would it not be better if it was covered through tuition so that you could later pay for it just like you're doing with your loans? That's all loans are. They're, hey, I'm going to take out a bunch of money. I'm going to pay it later because I can't afford it right now. Well, I can't afford to take care of insurance either. Why? Because I'm here. So would it not be better, would it not be more beneficial for us to go through our school and have it paid initially? According to Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, there is a serious challenge of college students getting enough sleep and maintaining too much stress from trying to balance classes, friends, homework, activities, family, everything. This can lead to mental health issues. With all of these stressors in their lives, they're more susceptible to illness and fatigue. How are students with no health insurance able to have the time or the money to spend on going to a doctor's visit because they feel depressed, because they feel anxious, because they're having problems that they don't know how to explain? According to the National Institute of Mental Health, 75% of all individuals with an anxiety disorder will experience symptoms before the age of 22. Okay, go.
Okay, whenever you're ready.
Oh, okay. Okay, so no one's really talked about the loss of liberty that comes with having to pay for health insurance through the university. At that point, there would be, the plans would all be kind of basic, so that way everyone would be paying the same price through tuition. And you wouldn't be able to choose what kind of plans you want. Maybe you just want detrimental coverage, you want full coverage. There's also the idea that UNT's Health and Wellness Center is fairly new, and it actually has 29 exam rooms, which people don't know, which is fairly big for the amount of people that use it. And it already receives 22,000 patients a year, so that's about the equivalent of a small ER. So for us to think that we can have 36,000 plus students on the same insurance plan all going to this one clinic, it's kind of, it's impractical. You also have to consider people, for example, ADD and ADHD people. They have to go usually to the doctor about once a month to get the prescription and they need to get blood testing. And that requires an actual appointment. It's not just walk in and get my prescription. So that alone would take up a lot of the time. And the wellness center here, at least, is only open from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. And it would just, it would kind of be ridiculous, I guess, to expect that we could handle that volume of patients. There's also, you guys mentioned a lot about what about those who are like depressed or have anxiety or just different things that come with the stresses of college. Well, we actually already have a psychology clinic, like you mentioned, and the Substance Abuse Resource Center. We even have massage therapy for very, very low cost, about half what you pay anywhere else. And these services are already funded primarily through your tuition as it is. And so... So to say that we don't have those or need a more extensive insurance plan to cover those so we can get those isn't true. There's also the, going along with the volume of patients, it says that according to the Association of American Medical Colleges Center for Workforce Studies, the ACA would increase the projected 2015 physician shortage by nearly 50%. 50%. So this means we'd have, we'd be sending a lot of people to, for example, physician's assistants or nurse practitioners who are very knowledgeable and very helpful, but they're not quite the same as someone might be like a full-on physician or surgical doctor, things like that. And so it's unrealistic to think that these mid-level providers can provide the same level of care as a fully trained physician. It kind of devalues the extensive medical care or medical school that doctors have to go through. There's also the drop in financial gains for hospitals, and according to a study by the clinics in dermatology, the healthcare system, particularly the the physician workforce is already operating at near or beyond capacity, and it's saying that some hospitals are still struggling financially, and that's not because of low occupancy, but rather the extensive subsidizing and things like that, the diminished revenues for the services they provide. A trend that will only increase if we continue to have students on this UNT or collegiate insurance plan.
Now it's the app summary.
Our pocket, according to the CNN Paycheck and Department of Education. So they're actually giving us money for this Health Care Act as well. That's my conclusion.
Yeah, and then the last speaker. Whenever ready.
So a really strong affirmative point that's constantly being brought up is that the minority matters. And yes, it's true, but why should we be forced to submit our liberty and likely accumulate larger debt for this minority? According to the 8% of college students that were insured, of the 20% that were not, only 7% bought their own policies or purchased one of the school-based plans. So out of the 20% that you're saying matters so much, why should it be necessary that we're only paying for 7% of students that actually need medical care? Furthermore, tuition already covers the basic and necessary services based on your statistical needs of students, the trauma and the need for ADD medicine, or well, that was our point, or you know, all that stuff like that. And so it's not a necessary need for students to have health care because it's already covered under a lot of universities. Tuition would definitely skyrocket, although they say it hasn't changed from 2011 to 2014. A lot of schools are actually canceling their health care now, and they're citing the ACA as the reason they've canceled their school-wide affordable health care plan. One in particular is Bowie State, a Maryland public school, that says Obamacare's new regulations would force the cost of the insurance to rise from $50 to $900 a semester. And that was cited just in 2013. Also, Cornell students, 40% were enrolled in student health care plans, quadruple the national average. And to keep up with the phasing, plans would have to have a minimum $100,000 payout limit, 10 times that of Cornell's plan, whose premium was $264 annually, and the college would have to agree to raise its premium to just under $2,500. And they say that that's pretty high. Finally, many services that healthcare provides are unneeded, which is stated by Pariser, who is citing about unnecessary healthcare costs and says that the healthcare system, particularly the physician workforce, is already operating at or near or beyond capacity. So students having to have more financial aid or having to have more healthcare, having to go to these clinics would cause an even greater capacity to these clinics and hospitals. Although there are some hospitals struggling financially, it's not because of low occupancy, but rather because of diminishing revenues for services provided, a trend that will only increase. The ACA is giving more people health insurance, but that doesn't mean they're going to get health care. This promise of health care without the adequate infrastructure to develop it will raise expectations that cannot be met and is ethically unjust. So in basic terms, we made clear points as to why tuition would skyrocket, as to the means that are provided already that makes healthcare unnecessary to all students, and why we shouldn't have to pay for the majority when there's only 7% of the 20% of students that don't have healthcare that are even looking to get it.
Cool. Let's give him a round of applause. Are you going to be here for this next debate as well?
Do I need to be?
Did he just tell you for this debate?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's cool. Will you mind if you wait? It's while we go to the restroom.
Okay.
Buddy needs help on that or something?
It says, thank you.
right there.
Oh, thank you.
Good debate, you guys.
I'm going to
die.
Let's just sign in.
No, it's going to be extra fun. I take it back. You suck.
Oh, excuse me. Can y'all, like, move somewhere?
So, by the way,
how you doing?
Pretty good.
Got one more to go, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you know where your teams are at? They're right here.
I think I'm not sure where they're at. I just got back to the restroom.
Easy way to help time you here.
Yeah, that'd be awesome. Yeah, if you're in a baby, go ahead and move towards the front.
I'm in Compton,
so the way it works is all of the instructions are 4 minutes and the process is 2 minutes. Pretty straightforward. Alright. And you got a time too, so I can time it as well.
This is the first time I've cracked it. I'm waiting because I'm not going to be able to do it. It's crazy because when you buy it, you buy the plan. When you buy the actual labels. Does it need to be in order?
Just. I need to know what speaker is speaking for which thing. I need to know specifically which speaker is doing which speech.
Okay.